Hello, and welcome to The Virtuous Life. I'm your host, Pat Oedy-Murray. And before we get rolling today with our guest, I just want to thank all of those members of Legatus last night that I had a great time at Legatus, and it was a, you guys were so gracious. A number of you say you listened to the show, and it was wonderful to be able to talk to you about bioethics, the hot topics, Catholic response, and had a lot of good questions afterwards. So thanks so much for the invitation. It was a joy to be with you. So today, however, I do want to jump in to our guest. I'm excited. I read this article and it just raised all kinds of questions. And so I'm excited to have with you, with us, Dr. James Matthew Wilson. He is the Cullen Foundation Chair in English Literature and the founding father of the Master of Fine Arts program in creative writing at the University of St. Thomas in Houston. So he's an award-winning scholar of philosophical theology and literature, dozens of essays, articles, and certainly we're going to be talking about one of those today. He has numerous books that he has published. One, I think, that will come up certainly in our discussion today, The Vision of Soul, Truth, Goodness, and Beauty in the Western Tradition. I think that's something that is an amazing thing that we need to kind of come back to and understand better. And his most recent one is I Believe in One God, Praying the Nicene Creed, which sounds excellent, too. So it's always a joy for me to have people like him on the show, because then I get connected to their books. And you know, I'm always looking for good books. So these are great, too. So welcome, Dr. Wilson. How are you today?
I'm well, thank you. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, well, thanks for coming on. I know you're a busy man. So I do want to ask you, though, because it says in your bio that you are the founding director of Master of Fine Arts program in creative writing. When did you do that? How long has it been around? Kind of what was the, you know, what was the thing that moved you toward that?
Yeah, that I'm glad to talk about that, because that's if you've ever thought of something that you did as standing at the edge of a cliff and making a big leap of faith, this was it. I had taught for a dozen years at Villanova University in Pennsylvania. And in a program called the Department of Humanities and Augustinian Traditions, which was an attempt, perhaps a failed attempt, but an attempt to restore the Catholic character of that university by having a program that was entirely formed on the personalist thought of John Paul II, and would really initiate students into the life of the Catholic mind.
Right.
I loved teaching that program, but my real calling in life was always to be a poet. I loved writing poetry. I've published three full-length collections. My next one will be out next year, from Word on Fire. So I was approached by one of my former publishers, who said that, named Joshua Wren, who's a novelist and a short story writer in his own right, and he said, what would you say if you could start your own Master of Fine Arts writing, Master of Fine Arts program in creative writing that would be thoroughly in the Catholic tradition?
Wow.
I said, well, that sounds great, but it's also probably a bad idea. And, because nobody's starting graduate programs now. They think they're setting up shop.
Yeah.
So he said, well, we have people who would really like to see something like that brought into existence. Mm-hmm. I said, well, I'll talk to them, but I don't think this is ever going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
and so for the next 6 or 7 months, I just kept sitting through meetings saying what people were talking about this, and I was saying nothing because I thought, this will never happen. This will never happen. And I just thought, as soon as I mention one or two objections, the whole thing will fold like a tent.
Right.
Well, I mentioned those objections and everybody just said, yeah, that's no problem.
So what you thought were problems were not problems. Yeah.
I really did. Yeah. And I couldn't believe it. So in April of 2021, we announced the Master of Fine Arts program in creative writing at the University of St. Thomas in Houston.
Wow.
It's the first and only such program in the world.
Oh, my gosh.
Where writers can apprentice themselves, and they can apprentice themselves not just to become great writers concentrated on craft and making things of beauty, but to do that with the full intellectual and literary tradition of the Catholic Church behind them and supporting them and helping them to cultivate their abilities.
Wow, that sounds amazing.
It's been the greatest blessing, one of the greatest blessings of my life for sure. And when we did it, I was so excited, scared, of course. I just didn't know if anybody was going to show up. In fact, we're now on our third year of having our cohorts, our incoming classes, mm-hmm. filled to capacity, and in fact, beyond capacity, really.
Really?
Yes. Yeah. I get notes from people all the time saying, I really wanted to learn how to write. I wanted to go to do a graduate program, but you know, the Contemporary Academy is such an abysmal place.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't want to risk their souls, as it were, or see the point of wasting their time in a classroom where they were not going to be learning what they really came to learn.
Right.
And so we've just become, you know, kind of a home and a refuge for all these people,
sure.
and also a way to help them really enter the writing life. And by that, I mean our students. We're just graduating our first class of students this July.
Okay.
But our students are already publishing publishing books and articles, poems and stories all over the place.
Wow.
It seems every day one of my students has a new publication. So they're already going out into the world and serving as a leaven to bring a Catholic vision of the art to the broader world.
Gosh, that's exciting. That is so exciting. What kind of prerequisites do they need in order to get into your program?
So our program is run online. It's run like an in-person program.
That okay.
is in all of our classes are three-hour seminars, just like those I did at Notre Dame.
Mm-hmm.
But we do it, you know, in the current way of the world on Zoom.
Mm-hmm.
And that's intentional. It's intentional for a couple of reasons. The program is located in Houston, but I live in Grand Rapids, Michigan, for instance.
So do you really? You're not that far away from me. Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm a Midwesterner at heart. So and in actual life. So that was intentional because we knew that the students that we wanted to draw you're going to usually be people who are full-time professionals, full-time mothers and fathers, or just doing other things, and they can't just drop everything they're doing for 2 years and go live in
right.
Houston, which is
exactly.
the usual model for an MFA program.
Right.
And to say that we were right would be an understatement. We have a Benedictine monk who lives in the desert outside Santa Fe, who is one of the first graduates of our program.
Oh, my.
We have a retired priest in Nebraska who is one of the first graduates of our program.
Mm.
We have a Catholic convert from Judaism who lives in Tel Aviv, who was one of the first students in our program. And so people all over the world, literally, are finding us and joining us. What we're looking for are, in the application process for the program is actually pretty simple because after a few months of doing it where it was a little bit more complicated, I realized, what do we actually care about?
Yeah,
and we
exactly.
only really care about two things. We care about the writing sample. Does the student have promise to actually be a publishable writer? Because we don't want to waste anybody's time.
Right.
They have potential.
Right.
And then we look at the statement of purpose, and
okay.
that's it. And would this person be, a proper fit
mm-hmm.
for our program? Are they alive mm-hmm. To the life of faith, to the life of the spirit? Are they alive to the reality of beauty? And if they are, we want them with us. Because we know that if we don't take them, they're not going to find a home elsewhere.
Right. Wow. That is just, that's exciting. That is very exciting. Wow. So how many people, because you said you just graduated, right? Your first class, if it's been,
They will in July.
They will in July.
We have a summer program that's not required, but optional.
Okay.
And so they will go through our 10-day summer seminar, and that will be their last class, and we'll have a grant, although a graduation ceremony actually on the last night, which they don't know about yet, but I'm not your listeners do.
So are you, like, how many will be your graduates then? Like, what number is the graduating class?
Graduating this summer, we have 9 students, five novelists, 4 poets. And then in the fall, we'll have another 6 graduating.
That's good. I mean, for master's programs nowadays, that's very good.
Well, so that doesn't actually speak to the total number of students in the program, because a lot of our students are going part-time. Students are classical school teachers.
Yeah.
And we try to make the program as flexible as possible so that people don't have any barriers to joining us if they belong in the program.
That's smart. That is really good. Yeah, because you're right. I mean, a lot of people can't dedicate the time to get through it in, you know, like 2 years. I'm going to be done or whatever. So that's wonderful that it can be flexible and work with them, too. That's wonderful. Jeez, this sounds like an amazing program. I'm going to keep my eyes peeled on this one. It's just, and the only one in the country is just phenomenal. So did you, and I want to get to the article, but this is just fascinating for me, but did you, if it's the only one in the country, where did you just kind of have, this is how we understand what this should look like, or were there programs somewhere that you looked at and said, I like this and I like that? And I want to pull it into our program. How did you kind of come up with this?
Yeah, on my end, one of the great delights of founding this program was that it took about 5 minutes to set up. All Joshua and I did was just look in at ourselves and say, what do we think that we needed to know to become Catholic writers, become writers who were steeped in the life of the church.
Right.
And so then we had, within a few minutes, we had a 10-course program.
Oh, yeah.
So all of our students had the opportunity to take seminars on the Catholic revivals, both the European Catholic Revival and then the American, the Catholic Imagination in American Literature. So they get the sort of literature of the 21st to the 20th century from the Catholic tradition, including Flannery O'Connor and Walker Percy and Thomas Merton and Evelyn Waugh and T.S. Eliot, et cetera. And then they all take a course in the philosophy of art and beauty.
Oh.
So they really know the whole, Western philosophical tradition going back to Plato and through Thomas Aquinas and Benedict XVI.
Okay.
But they learn it with beauty as the forming structure, which, as I argue actually in the book, The Vision of the Soul, that's actually the proper way to learn the Western philosophical tradition. So, and then we have a course called Foundations of the Catholic Tradition, which I love for a couple of reasons. The first writer our students read is Virgil, who of course was not a Catholic writer; he was a pagan Roman. But he was Dante's guide through hell and purgatory in the Divine Comedy, and then the great German Catholic writer of the 20th century, Theodor Hecker, he wrote a book about Virgil called Virgil, Father of the West, where his last chapter speaks of Virgil being the natural Christian. And what he means by that is that Virgil's poetry prepared the cultural ferment to receive Catholic revelation.
Got it.
And so our students read Virgil and then Augustine's Confession and Dante's Divine Comedy. So it's really kind of what you call a great books education, but with the end being not just simply a universal knowledge of the tradition, but to take that tradition into their souls and to turn it, to embrace it and to be transformed by it, but also to direct it so that it is aimed at, its telos is the making of good new works.
That sounds amazing. Just amazing. Well, okay. So I'm going to get into the article here. And I always tell my guests that these are more conversations than interviews. I'm just interested in ideas from the articles, and certainly we'll be probably coming back to some of these things that you've talked about in the program itself. But first of all, I want to kind of get to the title. You know, you talk about how the apostles spoke of the beauty of Christ. And as we kind of go through this article that is in The Catholic Thing, you're talking about beauty and truth, and obviously goodness is a part of that. But I was a little bit, I guess my big question is, how does beauty lead to truth? Or does beauty lead to truth? Or do they just coexist and you discover beauty first and then you discover truth? I'm trying to figure out how this all fits together in my head.
This is the question I spent the last 20 years thinking about. So the good news is I have something to say on this. The bad news is that it's not going to be exhaustive because you'll probably have to think about it too for another 20 years.
Exactly, yeah.
To put the question that you're raising in the terms that the philosophers I chat with would put it is, what's the relation of what the medievals called the transcendental properties of being?
Mm-hmm.
And what, if any, is the relation, or as the theologian Hans Urs von Balthasar put it, what's the circumcession of the transcendental? So that's to say, how do they exist in one another the way Father, Son, and Holy Spirit exist in one another as one nature?
Mm-hmm.
And so the first question is, what does it mean to talk about a transcendental property of being? Because when I hear the word transcendental, I think of hippies in San Francisco doing some kind of contemplation or trying to elevate with their legs crossed, right?
And that's
not what it means. It's a term that actually derives from Aristotle and the ancient classical tradition. And it means simply this: everything that is a being, but every being that is defined primarily by how it differs from other beings.
Mm-hmm.
So I exist, for instance, as a being, and elephants exist as a being. But what makes me human and the elephant an elephant is our having different essences, and our essences are ways of existing.
Mm-hmm.
So what defines us as kinds of being that can be known is what separates us rather than what holds us together.
Right.
But if we're both beings, then we have at least that much in common.
Mm-hmm.
And so the question that was raised was, how much do all beings have in common?
Mm.
In other words, what do they have in common that transcends their different kinds, their different ways of existing, their different essences?
Okay.
And so the first thing that you would notice is that when I talk about an elephant, I'm talking about an elephant. And when I talk about myself, I am a man. Okay? So,
right.
So that means that one thing we have in common is that we're both one. Not one together, as in there's no difference between me and the elephant, but the elephant is one elephant, and I am one person.
Right.
So there's a property of unity that belongs to being.
Okay.
All right? So we can say about any being, we can say it's a being. Well, that doesn't sound all that interesting, although actually it really is, because
because
if you think about it, you know, you've probably sat at a table where somebody who was trying to amaze you said, look, this table seems so solid, but it's really millions and millions and millions of atoms.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, he's right and he's wrong. I mean, it contains millions of atoms, but it's still a table.
Right.
And that's because it has the principle of unity that holds its being together. It has an integrity to itself.
Okay.
But so that is kind of a great mystery and a beauty,
mm-hmm.
a beautiful thing to think about. But things get a little more complicated with some of the other transcendentals. For example, speaking of a table before me,
mm-hmm.
If I say that I know that this is a table, then that means I know the truth about the table. But that also means that I could be wrong about the table if I thought the table, you know, was a barber chair or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
I could be mistaken.
Right.
So if it's possible to be right or wrong about the table, that means that there must be some quality of truth that inheres, that is to say, that intrinsically belongs to the being of a table.
Okay.
All right?
Right.
So truth is the transcendental property of being that relates beings, things that exist, to a knower.
Okay.
All right?
Right.
But then also, nothing would be if it weren't good for something. You know, I mean, we've all sat on the couch that our mom has said, as we're watching Wheel of Fortune, you're good for nothing. But we know that she doesn't mean it, right? We are good for something,
that's
but we
right.
wouldn't exist.
Exactly.
So what does it mean to be good? Well, good means to have been the end or the object of some prior action.
Okay.
So my parents begetting me, my childhood, my existence was the good of their union in marriage.
Right.
And then there's also, but then we say, okay, but now that you're good, now that you were the good of their union, you're not good for anything. Well, no, that's not true. I have a good.
Right.
I'm growing. My body and my soul are developing towards maturation and to a fullness of existence.
Mm-hmm.
And we say, well, what's the point of that existence? That your Baltimore Catechism will tell you the purpose of your existence is to know and to love and to serve God.
Right.
Okay. So,
right.
So both I'm the outcome, I'm the good of one operation,
mm-hmm.
but then I have an operation of my own that leads to a further good.
Right.
And as I become more fully myself, as I realize the telos or the aim for which God created me,
mm-hmm.
I become, to misuse a word, I become gooder. Okay.
Right.
So good also is a property of being. And I gave a kind of lengthy explanation about that, but it'd be easier to put it this way. We know that good is a property of being because we know what everything is in terms of what it's for.
Right. Its function.
You don't really understand what a saw is if you don't know what you use a saw for.
Right.
You don't know what a hammer is, so on and so forth. So,
right.
So good must be a property of being.
Mm-hmm.
What things are, their forms or their essences, follows from their function, what they're good for.
Okay.
The makers of BMWs who say form follows function were Aristotelians. They didn't know it, but they are. But then things get a little tricky. All right, so being one makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
Being true is the relationship of a being to knowledge or knowing.
Mm-hmm.
Being good seems to relate beings to the appetite, that is to say, the movement of the will to achieve things.
Right.
But why is beauty stuck in there? Why do so many people in the tradition refer to beauty as a transcendental property of being?
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't seem to really make any sense that it should be tagged on there because beauty seems so superficial to us.
Right, it does,
But it didn't seem superficial to the ancient world and to the great minds of the Catholic Church, including Thomas Aquinas,
mm-hmm.
because beauty is, in fact, that fundamental property of being that allows them to give themselves away in the first place. That is to say, when you, let me give you an example. What my favorite movie, aside from Frank Capra's It's a Wonderful Life, is John Ford's The Quiet Man. And as John Wayne is going through the Irish countryside with McLean O'Flynn, the leprechaun,
right.
he looks out at a hillside, and there's beautiful Maureen O'Hara with her red hair
mm-hmm.
and her sheep coming down the pasture as she's tending the sheep as a shepherdess.
Right.
And John Wayne looks at her, his neck recoils, and he looks at McLean O'Flynn, and he says, "Hey, is that real?" He doesn't know who she is or what she is. He's just seeing a vision, and it's overwhelmed him.
Right.
And that is an encounter with beauty. Beauty is this property of beings that first gives themselves to us, not as objects of knowledge, not as things of desire, though they may eventually be that too,
sure.
but as just the ability for us to recognize that things exist, and they want to be seen by us. They want to be known by us. The reason we call objects, you know, is because they object to us, like a lawyer in court. They throw themselves at us and say, "Look at me." So that's one dimension of beauty. And in fact, I mentioned Aristotle earlier. I'll mention him again. He, at the beginning of his Metaphysics, he says, all philosophy begins in wonder. What is wonder? It's a desire to know the truth about something. But it's a desire to know the truth about something. So in other words, you want to know what's true, but you think it would be good to know what is true. So truth and goodness come together in wonder. What is this phenomenon called wonder? Well, you wouldn't wonder about things if there weren't things to make you wonder about them. So if philosophy begins in wonder, if our mind's first operation is this going out of itself in wonder at the things of the world,
mm-hmm.
that must be not an initiative of our own, but rather a response. A response to what? To the world itself that first throws itself at us to make us wonder about it. So if philosophy begins in wonder, but wonder is provoked or first inspired by our encounter with the world,
mm-hmm.
that means the world itself must be wonderful. which is why Jimmy Stewart's movie is so wonderful, because right. It is a wonderful life. Everything's yeah. wonderful, but everything's a cause of wonder.
Right.
And so that's just what we might call the primal phenomenon that people experience in the world. Ourselves first come to interact with the world at large by our experience of beauty. That is to say, that initial shock where we say, hey, is that real?
Yeah.
Grabs
our attention, right.
Yeah. And that's why children, children are great exemplars of wonder, even though adults have as much wonder as children do. I know I was picking up my 4-year-old John Cassian from preschool the other day, and as I was walking on the sidewalk, there was a pine cone. And I just grabbed the pine cone, and when he came to the door of the preschool, I just put the pine cone in his hand.
Mm-hmm.
He goes, "Oh, a pine cone!" he wasn't asking the question, "What are pine cones really?" You
right.
know, he was
yeah.
not doing that. He was just marveling in the existence of the pine cone for a moment,
yeah.
and then he moved on to have a snack. But so that's part of what the nature of beauty is, that initial shock or tremble or just wonder of beings as they give themselves to us. But it's not the whole story about beauty. Jacques Maritain, the great Catholic philosopher, said that beauty in truth is the sum of all, is the radiance of all the transcendentals combined, he says.
Hmm.
And I don't even know if he knew what he meant by that when
right.
he wrote it.
Right.
It's just a stray note. It's a beautiful sentence, but he doesn't really explain it. But I think I know what he meant by it, because I've been thinking about that sentence for 20 years and trying to make sense of it. And the gist of it would be something like this. When we see that things exist, but that nothing exists alone, but all things exist in relation to everything else. For example, that elephant I mentioned earlier, mm-hmm. the elephant exists and I exist. And we say, we're so different. It's as if we have nothing in common. But we do have something in common. His nose, he has a nose and I have a nose, but his nose is long and mine is short. And so I actually can see between us this relationship in difference, a ratio, or what the Thomas Aquinas would have called a ratio,
mm-hmm.
a kind of relationship or intelligible difference. So also, he's 4-footed, I'm 2-footed. He weighs 2 tons. I weigh significantly less than that. All these
right.
ratios just begin to crop up, and we can spend actually a lot of time thinking, yeah, what are the differences between me and an elephant? And
right.
we can see those relationships.
Okay. All right.
Well, if you keep, let me get one more sentence in.
Okay.
If you keep doing that and you just think about the whole world, you can see that the whole world forms an intelligible whole of relationships, all of which taken together reveal that the world itself was created by an intelligent, unified mind.
Okay.
And when you see that, then you've experienced beauty at its uh-huh. fullness.
I love this, but we are already at break time. So I have to let the audience know today we are talking with Dr. James Matthew Wilson, Cullen Foundation Chair in English Literature and the Founding Director of the Master of Fine Arts Program in Creative Writing at the University of St. Thomas in Houston. And we're talking about truth, beauty, and goodness, but especially an article that he wrote on beauty. So come back on the other side of the break as we continue to delve into this idea of beauty. You're listening to The Virtuous Life. I'm your host, Pat Oedy-Murray.
The Catholic Church teaches that Jesus Christ is literally and wholly present, body and blood, soul and divinity, under the appearances of bread and wine. St. John the Apostle records the John chapter 6 Bread of Life discourse, in which Jesus states that his flesh is true food and his blood true drink. Who better to understand John's writings and subsequent teachings than a disciple and student of John, St. Ignatius of Antioch? In his letter to the Smyrnians in 110 AD, Ignatius writes, "I have no taste for corruptible food, nor for the pleasures of this life. I desire the bread of God, which is the flesh of Jesus Christ. And for drink, I desire his blood, which is love incorruptible." The Catholic Church absolutely follows St. John and St. Ignatius in taking Jesus at his word. Examining the truths of the Catholic faith, this is faithforensics.org.
Welcome back to The Virtuous Life. I'm your host, Pat Oedy-Murray, and today I'm excited we have with us Dr. James Matthew Wilson. He is the Cullen Foundation Chair in English Literature and the founding director of the Master of Fine Arts Program in Creative Writing at the University of St. Thomas in Houston. I would, if you have any desire to write and to understand the Catholic tradition in writing, I would encourage you to go look at this program. Again, University of St. Thomas in Houston, and also go back to the beginning of the podcast, when this airs, you can go back again and listen to it later, because, he talks about this program and it sounds phenomenal. In fact, it's rolling around in my head that I should look at it, although I don't think I'd pass the writing sample, but welcome back, Dr. Wilson.
Thank you.
We're talking about beauty, and you gave this great understanding of it in the first part of the show. I want to kind of ask you, because that does not appear to be our understanding of beauty in today's society. How you connected all of that for us in the first half of the show.
Yes.
Where did we kind of go off the rails in our understanding of beauty?
Yes. Alas, you can see the exact moment. the description of beauty that I gave in the first half of the show was in different permutations, the understanding of beauty that every serious person had from Plato and Aristotle up through, Plotinus, the great Neoplatonist philosopher, the Dionysius the Areopagite, the great Christian monk, mm-hmm. and on to St. Bonaventure and St. Thomas and Dante. And it's an understanding that's available to us now. It's not as if it was surpassed, but it is an understanding of beauty that was betrayed.
Right.
And where was it betrayed? It was betrayed by in two ways, beginning in the 17th century.
Okay.
The first was this. Important early modern thinkers such as Francis Bacon, Thomas Hobbes, and René Descartes wanted to help make advances in the experimental sciences possible. And they found that that you could actually make scientific advances if you treated things as not having integrity of their own, but it's just so many parts.
Okay.
And so if you try to reduce things to their parts, you're no longer thinking about them as whole.
Okay.
And so at that moment, they began to drain the idea of beauty of any meaning, because beauty always wants to put things together. It
right.
wants us to see things whole, whereas what they were trying to do was to think of the world as just the extension of so many parts.
Okay.
And so from that moment onward, modern thinkers tend to not think of beauty as anything other than a subjective feeling that we may have.
Okay.
Well, in the 18th century, the great thinker Edmund Burke, and then his, the philosophers Hume in Scotland, and then Immanuel Kant in Germany.
Mm-hmm.
They said, okay, beauty can just be a feeling. But you know what? Feelings are what make us human.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's good to have feelings. And that began the long tradition of what I would call sentimentalism,
mm-hmm.
thinking of beauty and, incidentally, of morality as not being related to the truth, but being related to goodness and beauty in isolation from the truth.
Mm-hmm.
So that we begin to say, you can be good, but goodness is not necessarily related to reality or to truth as a whole. Things can be beautiful, but beauty has no intrinsic relationship to the truth of being. And this is a modern innovation that had those two steps. First, mm-hmm. the stripping of beauty from the world and reduction of it to feeling, mm-hmm. and then the celebration of that feeling by these other philosophers, but they never, they had no intention or no means, intellectual means at their disposal to reconnect the feeling of beauty with any kind of perception of reality. And so even though most people have not read Edmund Burke, they haven't read Immanuel Kant, and, lucky
right.
for them,
right.
those kinds of thinkers really came to pervade our culture.
Right.
I'll just give you one quick example of it. whenever I talk to young people about the reality of beauty, they might be tempted to say, well, beauty's just subjective. It's just what you feel.
Exactly.
Well, okay. Mm-hmm. You know, that's Immanuel Kant. That's mm-hmm. right out of his wheelhouse. Now, Immanuel Kant says, yes, but we all have human nature. So our feelings, if we're good human beings, should be the same. Mm-hmm. But that's, the students don't like that part. Right?
Yeah, exactly.
But I say to those same students, okay, so let's say I came up to you at, a college party on a weekend, and I tried to impress you by saying, the most beautiful song ever written is Baby Shark. You know, that song, I won't try to sing it for
Please,
you, but
yeah.
it's, you know, you hear it at baseball games, et cetera. And, you know, the response of that person would never be, oh, that's how you feel. Great, great. No,
right.
the response would be to back away slowly and try to find somebody else to talk to.
Exactly.
So, we know that beauty has some kind of purchase, some kind of connection to reality.
Mm-hmm.
We know that somebody who says Baby Shark is better than Beethoven is probably nuts.
Yeah.
Okay. We know it.
Right.
even though, people might be able to appreciate, you know, Calder's modern, I'm thinking of the Calder we have here in Grand Rapids,
mm-hmm.
giant metal sculptures that look like shark's teeth. Even though people might be able to appreciate those as having a certain kind of beauty, if you hold that up to next to Michelangelo's David, almost every person is going to respond, man, why can't we just have Michelangelo's David?
Yeah.
Why can't we have that instead?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. And if somebody says, no, that's not true, well, then build a giant housing project like those on the south side of Chicago that were demolished 20 mm-hmm. years ago, and say, okay, mm-hmm. you get to go live here.
Right.
Nobody would want to live in those spaces. They might admire the ability of man to build buildings that go so high up in the air,
mm-hmm.
but nobody would want to be cloistered in the kind of morbid, imprisoning spaces of such a building. They're very inhuman.
Right.
But they're not just inhuman. They're not fully beautiful.
Exactly.
So we know that we have a criterion of beauty, and we might be tempted to ignore it or dismiss it, but human beings are tempted to ignore the truth. They're tempted to ignore goodness as well.
Right.
And that's something that we do at our peril.
Yeah. Well, I love that. Yeah, because I always say that, too. I think so often we have a lot of the modern art things that are out there. People kind of have to tell us those are beautiful because we just don't feel they are. You know, it's like when I look at them, I'm like, yeah, okay, no. You know, and even like you said, buildings. When I see like, you know, around here, they're remodeling fast food places and I drive by some and they're just these gray, you know, block kind of, and I'm thinking, boy, that's really ugly. Why would I want to go eat there? I mean, it's like, you know, so it does resonate within us, but a lot of times we don't think much about it and what it's connected to. We just kind of think it's our emotions. Well, that's my feelings are telling me that, but there's really something deeper than that at work.
Yeah. Just imagine driving past one of those buildings and saying, oh boy, that's ugly, but well, you can't stand in the way of progress. If progress is ugly, I don't want it.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I'm with you. That's for sure. Well, I want to get into the point of kind of this article where you lay out, you talk about, obviously how the apostle spoke of the beauty of Christ is the title of the article. And you kind of use, Peter, how Peter talks, addresses the Jews. You talk about, how Paul preaches in different ways that he preaches, to the Athenians differently than, what he does others. But he tends to also share kind of his own witness, his own history. Somebody who's reading this article, like me, as I was reading it, I thought, okay, it appears to me that he is talking here about truth, that they are, you know, the apostles are laying out the truth. This is what, you know, who Jesus is. This is how we know who he is. And Paul even, you know, preaching to the Athenians about this kind of their higher philosophical desires. This is what you're really looking for, you know. So he's kind of approaching it through the sense, in my, and of course I teach moral theology, so in my eyes, this is through the sense of truth. And then you kind of jump in and say, all three of these articles or arguments are from beauty. And I think that's where people go, huh? I thought we were talking about truth. And so you talk about, you know, for the beautiful was the term used for the wonder and delight born in us. And that's kind of what you talked about in the beginning of the show, how we see things that fit together, orderliness, those kinds of things. So can you give us a little more insight in looking at those kind of three specific arguments that you talk about, how these three talked about Christ, and make that connection with beauty for us a little bit more?
Absolutely, yes. So so to begin with, I mentioned early in the show the idea of the circumcession of the transcendental. That is to say that truth, goodness, and beauty are properties of being, but they're not just properties of being the way my arms are a property of my body, my legs are a property of my body, as if they had no interconnection with each other.
Right.
In fact, anywhere you encounter beauty, you're encountering truth and goodness as well. And in fact, the way I described it, it was, we have that initial shock of beauty, and then the mind goes out in desire, so it moves towards goodness. And what does it move towards? It moves towards trying to understand truth. And then when we have the truth, we say, ah, now I see how that truth fits in with all these other truths I know. And I'm beginning to build an image of the world, a coherent image of how the whole world fits together, that all these truths are not simply isolated factoids. They are, they form a whole that's greater than the sum of their parts. And we say, what is that whole that's greater than the sum of the parts? Well, it's the beauty of truth. Mm-hmm. It's the splendor of truth, the beauty of truth showing forth. If you, you know, I'm a great defender of the liberal arts, the study of philosophy, literature, and theology for their own sake, as humanizing disciplines and as perfective of the mind. And so if somebody says, well, we really want James on our team in the trivia contest because he knows a lot of trivia, he's read all those books and things, I get a little bit upset because I didn't read my Plato and Aristotle so I could know a bunch of facts about Plato and Aristotle or about St. Augustine or Thomas Aquinas. I learned it so that that my soul could itself become a whole greater than the sum of its parts. Mm-hmm. That all those things I learn will somehow mutually inform and nourish one another to make something greater than just a bunch of information in the phone book.
Right.
And so what I'm describing there is truth actually ordered to beauty. Truth forming, in that case, the goal of liberal education is to form a beautiful soul out of the truths that are brought into the soul through study. And that's what happens with the apostles. So just to give you the first instance, the earliest instances of preaching that we find in the Acts of the Apostles are happening right at the time of Pentecost, which will be coming up pretty quick. So
yep,
it's good timing.
Exactly.
Peter steps out into the street to address the Jews from every nation who have come to Jerusalem. And he begins reciting for them the history of the scriptures. He does this, and he does it multiple times. And so so also does Paul.
Mm-hmm.
That is to say, this is a mode of preaching that gets repeated multiple times, and it has to be repeated multiple times because there's so many ways to go about it.
Right.
What is the way to go about it? It's to go through the scriptures and to show that the scriptures, the Torah, especially with Moses, and then the books of the prophets, the works of the prophets, Isaiah and Jeremiah, and the prayers of the Psalms and so forth, that all of these books and all of this sacred history of God's dealing with the Jews is prophetic of one who will come after the Christ, who will fulfill all these things.
Mm-hmm.
Now, there's no logical argument that just speaks at the level of truth without beauty that could make that connection. Because what you have to say is, this whole pattern of revelation of Moses and the prophets leaves out in front of it, just beyond it where it ends, a sort of empty space that needs to be filled. And so something needs to be fitted into that space.
Okay.
That will fulfill the pattern that was previously expressed or described. And anytime we're talking about the fitting, we're talking about beauty. Okay. Beauty is the way in which we see the ratios of the world fit together.
Together. Okay.
And just to give you an example, think of any story you've ever been told. When you're hearing a story, it's just one darn thing after another.
Mm-hmm.
But then when you get to the climax of the story and there's something happens that's a sudden revelation that just turns you around and forces you to look back on everything you've seen up to that point.
Mm-hmm.
And you say, ah, now I see why so-and-so left a gun sitting, you know, on the
right.
Wardrobe. Now I see how this all fits together.
Right.
That is the logical outworkings of beauty, where we see how things had to be the way they are, even though as we were experiencing them, they seemed entirely contingent. They didn't seem as if there was any connection at all. But then we look back and we see how it all fits together. That's why Dorothy Sayers has a wonderful essay on how Aristotle, in his Poetics, in his theory of how poetry works, of how stories work,
mm-hmm.
Is actually the great progenitor of the detective novel.
Oh.
Because if a detective novel doesn't fit together, if you don't at the end say, oh, why didn't I see that that was the guy was the murderer? If you don't have that experience at the end of the book, then the book's a failure.
Right, it is.
It has to be a complete puzzle that's completely obscure or opaque to you until the moment when, seeing it fulfilled, you look back and say, oh, it all fits together now.
Right. And that's that
right.
moment of wonder, right, that you talk about. Yeah.
Exactly. And so that's what Peter and the disciples do to the Jews. They to put it very crudely, they say, the books of the prophets are all mystery stories, and now we have
right.
the answer to our mystery in Jesus Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Right.
So St. Paul goes then, after he's preached this way a number of times to the Jews, who have this particular history, this covenant with God, of whom Jesus is both the fulfillment but also the absolute transformation, because now we have a new covenant. But Paul goes to the Areopagus, which means just the center of Athens, where all the philosophers and gossips of Athens got together to talk about things. And,
mm-hmm.
You know, the Acts of the Apostles is a very funny book. It's a really clever book. And we're hearing a lot of it,
yeah.
St. Luke says, you know, the Athenians did practically nothing but talk about things.
Mm-hmm.
They're just a bunch of garrulous, gossips.
Yeah.
But what he's talking about is that Athens is the home of philosophy, of Socrates and Aristotle, of all these people who make a way of life out of talking about ideas.
Right.
And so here we have these sort of somewhat decadent Athenian philosophers who just love to hear anything. They'll listen to anything interesting because they're always in search of a new idea.
Uh-huh.
And St. Paul stands in their midst and he points to a stone in the Areopagus and he says, this stone says, altar to the unknown God. And then he explains to the Greeks, and we only get part of the discussion in Luke, but you can kind of surmise from the chapter what's going on. He explains to the Greeks how their theory of the world as having a logos, that is to say, a principle of intelligibility that causes all things to be,
mm-hmm.
so that separate beings exist,
mm-hmm.
but they're part of one system that we call the cosmos. St. Paul is saying, I can now name for you the logos of God. Well, what does John's gospel tell us? In the beginning was the word. In the beginning was the logos.
Right.
Who is the logos? Jesus Christ is the eternal word,
mm-hmm.
excuse me, the eternal logos of God. And so St. Paul appeals to their understanding of the beauty of the world, that the world holds together, that it is a great circulating system where everything has its place and its part and all things have their purposes and all seems to be ordered by one supreme mind. They just don't know the name of that mind.
Right.
And Paul says, look, I can fit the missing piece of the jigsaw puzzle for you. I can tell you the name of Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So yet again, that's an argument from the fitting, from the beautiful.
Right. I love that.
It's not that it's not about truth. It's that beauty is one of our ways of perceiving truth. Plato, I'll mention something real quickly. So Plato, in his great dialogue, the Phaedrus, he tells us two things that are actually quite important for understanding the whole weight of what St. Paul is saying there. The first thing is that in the Phaedrus, Plato actually offers one of the earliest definitions of beauty in the whole Western tradition. Mm. And he says that beauty is nothing other than the splendor, that is to say, the shining forth or radiance of truth, of ideas,
right?
True ideas. Okay? So he already has a connection between beauty and truth placed there, that beauty is the way in which we see truth fitting together and making sense and going beyond itself.
Right.
But then he also does one other thing. In the Phaedrus, people who have never read any Plato, they probably heard, nonetheless, that when Plato was asked, or Socrates was asked, what is the soul? He said, well, the soul is a charioteer in his chariot who's driving two winged horses, one of whom is good and helpful, and the other one is refractory and stubborn like a mule. And so that's what the soul looks like. That is to say, it's a mind with a good appetite that wants what is good, but also kind of questionable aggressiveness and other qualities that surround that appetite that we're not always comfortable with. Lustfulness, for instance, which we obviously shouldn't be comfortable with.
Right.
And he says, he proceeds to say, and that soul, or rather all souls, circulate. That is to say, they parade through the heavens in a great circle. And, you know, whoever's first listening to Socrates say this in Plato's dialogue probably says, what is this guy going on about?
Yeah.
And then you realize by the end that what he's just described to you is the circulation of the stars and the planets. He's described the whole cosmos, or what we would now call the solar system.
Right.
And so what he's describing there is the movements of the soul, and he's trying to give a true vision of the world. But that true vision is one rooted in the idea of the cosmos, the world as a beautiful order that's governed by souls or by spirit or mind. So Paul's audience, they know they're Plato.
Right.
They're Greeks. They're Plato's descendants, his great-grandchildren. So when Paul makes this argument, they have the whole history of Greek philosophy behind them to say, oh, I know what this guy's going on about. And so then when he puts that missing piece into place, it clicks. And it's like they've been, just like the Jews waiting through the centuries of the Old Covenant for the coming of the Messiah, the Greeks, too, were waiting for somebody who could tell them who is the Logos who made this great cosmos that we know and study.
Right. That's great. I love that. And as you were talking about it, it dawns on me, too, that in the way Paul approaches things is a great way for us in evangelization, right? I mean, it's the same kind of thing with people who don't believe in a God. Where do you start? You know, you kind of start where Paul started with the Athenians. For people who do believe in a God, how do you do this? Well, you look at how Peter and Paul talk to the Jews about who this God is and who Christ is. So it's a great kind of a format, I think, for us today to take a harder look at. That's for sure. We've only got about, I think, 3 minutes, Nick just told me. So I want to give, and I know this is probably a hard thing to do in 3 minutes, but you talked about your love for the liberal arts, obviously, and that you called them humanizing disciplines. And we certainly live in more of a utilitarian approach to education nowadays. How do you bring people around to appreciating that real, true education is about the liberal arts? Because most people see that as a waste of time.
Yes. So I always love to go back to Alexis de Tocqueville's book, Democracy in America, which is such a wonderful account of what Americans were like, even, you know, in the early 19th century. And we were hustlers, as one historian puts it. We were always on the move, sometimes hustling in the sense of being con artists, but always hustling in the sense of trying to make a living, to get ahead, to secure our fortunes, and so on and so forth. What's so helpful about looking back to Tocqueville, is he says, what's remarkable about American society is everybody works.
Mm-hmm.
So work is non-negotiable in our society. And I'm not interested in negotiating it. I love to work.
Right, yeah.
What we have to recognize is that when you are an accountant, when you are a businessman, when you are an engineer, those are callings, and those are genuine good callings, and they're using your dynamic energy, your active life for a good end. But they can never be the fulfillment of your life, because you are not an engineer all the way down to your boots.
Mm-hmm.
You are first and foremost human. That is to say, someone created in the image of God for no other purpose, ultimately, than to know God.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't have in your life the resources to come to a deep, prayerful, still, even silent knowledge of God, then you're kind of doing it wrong.
Mm-hmm.
You're not doing the things that you were put into this world to do. And so the liberal arts are not the only way, but they are one of the chief ways by which human beings have sought to discipline the mind, that the mind can be opened up and prepared to receive the truth and to know it and to love it. I always think of the little old ladies at daily mass with me are also true intellectuals, because they know the purpose of their life.
Sure.
They are praying, kneeling before the altar in contemplation.
Yeah.
But we have to recognize that's a beautiful way to go about it. But it's not, for a lot of people, the most fruitful way, not to the exclusion of prayer, but as in they need some intellectual discipline to help them focus their mind on the nature of God.
Right.
And so that's what the liberal arts serve to do.
That's great. Well, we are all right. We're out of time. This was just such a fast interview. I would love to be in one of your classes. I want to let the audience know our guest today was Dr. James Matthew Wilson. He's the Cullen Foundation Chair in English Literature and the founding director of the Master of Fine Arts Program in Creative Writing at the University of St. Thomas in Houston. Thanks so much, Dr. Wilson, for being with us.
Thank you. God bless.
And have a beautiful week, audience, ahead. You've been listening to The Virtuous Life. I'm your host, Pat Oedy-Murray.
Let the voice of truth.